Hello and welcome to a special interview for The Wire, supported by Glenlivet Books. How have we ended up with a coal problem which for many looks, in fact, like a coal crisis? What went wrong? And equally importantly, where does the responsibility lie? Those are the key issues I shall raise today with one of India's most illustrious former coal secretaries, Anil Swarup. Mr. Swarup, as a former coal secretary, there are few people who understand the coal picture better than you do. So can you start by explaining what went wrong between 2016, when I believe Coal India had extensive reserves, perhaps as many as 35,000 crore, and there were ample coal stocks in the country, and today, when there seems to be a shortage of coal and a sense of crisis?
There are two aspects to this whole issue. You may call it a crisis or otherwise, that's semantics. But we are certainly short of coal. And one part relates to the demand side management. The other is supply side management. From demand side, I think post-COVID, their economy is recovering both in India and elsewhere in the world. And hence, there is a demand for power and consequently demand for coal as well. This has also led to increase in coal prices. Similarly, in India, the economy is on recovery mode. And there is demand for more power, and that has led to demand for more coal. The other aspect is the unseasonal rain that happened. But these are aspects over which we have absolutely no control. Demand will go up and down. What we have control of is supply side management. And where does the supply of coal come from? It comes from two prominent sources. One is Coal India Limited, which produces 80% of coal that is required in India, and 20% around come from the private sector. Let us look at what happened to Coal India after 2016, as you rightly said. In 2016, the situation was such that we were even toying with the idea of exporting coal to Bangladesh. What went wrong after that? I think one of the primary aspects was the role that was played by Mr. Sudhir Bhattacharya, who was then the chairman of Coal India, who did a fantastic job in increasing coal production of this country. His tenure ended in 2017, and ironically, no regular chairman was appointed in Coal India. Now, how can you run a company like that without a regular chairman for full 1 year? So all the tempo momentum that was built between 2014 and 16 was lost thereafter. Of course, thereafter, we did have regular chairman, but took a long time to recover. So this was one of the prominent reasons. Just to add to it, even today, there are a number of subsidiaries in Coal India which do not have the chairman, which is very surprising. Without the top management being there, how do you expect decisions to be taken? So one was human resource mismanagement, as I call it, should have been done. The second was, you pointed towards the reserves of 35,000 crores in 2016. What happened to those reserves? In fact, I distinctly remember we had worked out an extensive plan of expansion of existing coal mines and opening of new coal mines. Without doing that, how do you increase production? You know, ironically, the Coal India production has stagnated to around 600 million tons for the past three years. If that be the case, how can you meet the demand? So coal production of Coal India had to go up. And one way of going up is expansion of those mines, as I said, and opening new mines. Now, this money ought to have been invested in this for this purpose. Unfortunately, most of this money was taken out as dividend to balance the budget of the government. So you didn't have human resource or at the top, you didn't have the top management. You didn't utilize the money that would have been utilized for expansion of coal mines and opening coal mines. What do you expect? Coal production can't go back. Just a couple of more points. The third point that I would like to bring to your notice is, and it appears to be pretty ridiculous, is that how it was. There was nothing wrong with Swachh Bharat Abhiyan. It was a brilliant program of the government and much needed program. But I never understood the fact that hundreds of coal mine managers who should have been planning and executing those plans in the field for coal mines were deputed to supervise digging of shitholes. In fact, in my book, Ethical Dilemmas of a Civil Servant, in a chapter called Shit Happens, I have explained this point to illustrate that how ridiculous can we be. I had jokingly mentioned that the tagline of Coal India should be changed to "We set up toilets, we also produce coal." And it was pretty bad because it shouldn't have been that way. Coal mine managers should have been working on mines. And finally, the fourth point was that Coal India, instead of investing in mines, was pushed to invest in fertilizer plants. It was all very shocking. So these four factors were responsible for Coal India not maintaining the momentum that it had in 2016. The other part is the private sector part, because as I said, 20% of the coal comes from the private sector. here, I think the problem began with the rampaging CAG in 2014, who ensured that more than 200 blocks allocation were cancelled. There was 90 million tons of coal being produced by these private sector at that point in time, and all stopped. Now, to revive that, new coal blocks were auctioned. In the beginning, what we did was we set up a coal project monitoring group to monitor the clearances. As you might be aware, that you know, working on a coal mine and getting coal excavated is not an easy job. You have to have land, you have to have environmental forest clearance, and it is a very cumbersome process. So both Coal India Limited and the private entities required assistance from the government for getting these clearances, both from the state government and the central government. Now, this brings me to the next point. Majority of the role in these clearances is played by the state government. The tragedy is and was in the past few years that the center and the state governments are at war. There's hardly any dialogue between the two. I distinctly recall that between 2014 and 2016, I did not convene a single meeting in Delhi. I used to travel to the state headquarters, sit with the state officials, with district collectors on the video, on video conference, and used to discuss each of the issues to sort them out. All this led to acquisition of enormous amount of land and environment forest clearance. Now, if you don't have this land, you don't have this environment forest clearance, even if you have money, you will not be able to excavate coal. So we played the role of a facilitator both for the private as well as the public sector Coal India Limited. So private sector coal has not come up the way it should have. And finally, I think commercial mining should have started in 2015. The Prime Minister was very clear. I distinctly remember in a discussion, he said, why don't we have commercial mining, after he was told that we should have commercial mining. For some reason, this file was not sent to him, and the decision was taken only after 5 years. Now, imagine if commercial mining had commenced in 2015, what would have been the coal production today? Because coal production from any new mine takes at least 5 to 6 years before it starts production. So cumulatively, all these reasons resulted in stagnation of coal production from Coal India, as also a stagnation of coal production within the country, even from the private sector.
You've given me, Mr. Swaroop, several reasons, very powerful reasons, why in fact we have not just a problem, but what many consider a sense of crisis around coal production in the country today. Very briefly, a lot of these reasons that you've given have to do with the mishandling of the coal industry by the government. It failed to appoint a CMD for at least a year. It even today, as you pointed out, has hundreds of subsidiaries of Coal India where there are no chairmen. It sucked out reserves, as a result of which Coal India couldn't expand or couldn't open new mines. Worse still, hundreds of managers of Coal India were deputed to do work for Swachh Bharat, as you put it, digging toilets. You call them shitholes, rather than concentrating on the work they're meant to do. And then when it comes to the private sector was hamstrung by the impact of the CAG report of 2014, which not only shut down over 200 blocks that produced 90 million tons of coal, but then when bidding happened, encouraged people to bid recklessly. Many of those companies that I believe won blocks actually failed to function because the bids were unrealistic. In addition, CPMG, which was in existence to help for clearances, became defunct, and there was a delay in opening up commercial mining of at least 5 years. And finally, relationships between the center and the states became so poor that actually it seemed as if the center was at war with the states, and clearances again were held up. All of this, and I repeated it on purpose, but all of this adds up to one simple thing. It suggests mishandling by the central government, which I presume is a result of its indifference to the coal industry and its failure to think ahead. Would you agree all of this boils down to mishandling by the central government?
See, in 2016, I think situation became very comfortable. So when situation becomes comfortable, everyone thinks that everything is fine, hunky-dory, and nothing will go wrong, without realizing that in an evolving economy on a country like ours, things will change and we need to prepare ourselves. The government should have prepared itself. There were warning signals right through. It's not that they weren't there. They were not in the form of a crisis that we face today. But I think central government should have seen to it, should have done that. But I think there was a bit of an indifference, as a consequence of which we face a crisis today.
You are saying something very interesting. There were clear-cut warning signals after 2016, which the government did not heed. Have I understood that correctly?
Yes, absolutely. In fact, if you read my book, in that chapter itself, I say that there is a crisis at hand. The crisis will recur. And when these guys was being deployed, I had protested. I had said that right now it might appear that the situation is very comfortable. But if these mine managers do not do their work, because, you know, in work in coal is different from work elsewhere. Elsewhere, the results are immediately visible. In coal, you have to work and the results will be visible a few years down the line.
So can I stop and interrupt and put this to you? You had actually warned them about deputing coal managers to do Swachh Bharat work. The warning signals, as you said earlier, were clear and apparent, and the government didn't heed them. Doesn't this then amount to irresponsibility?
That's semantics. You can term it whichever way you want. But I think the signals
were
there.
How would you term it? I'm calling it irresponsibility.
I prefer the word indifference because, you know, there was that comfort. You know, when we were talking in terms of exporting coal to Bangladesh, in fact, at some point in time, it was seller's market in 2016, it became buyer market. You won't believe it because earlier people were running to coal India.
Let's not go into details about what could have happened in 2016 in terms of Bangladesh. It's an interesting story, but it's a side story. I want for the audience to establish the level of responsibility. You prefer the word indifference to irresponsibility. I want to ask you, what's the difference between the two? If you are
the difference is,
okay, let me finish. If you are indifferent to warnings given by the coal secretary, if you are indifferent to other warnings coming from within the industry, then isn't that irresponsibility? Why do you prefer the word indifference?
There was no warning coming from the industry at all. So I was a bureaucrat trying to explain to them, as most of you feel that bureaucrats don't have the right kind of thinking. They might have also thought, it's so comfortable. What is the problem? You're talking in terms of exporting to Bangladesh. No one is crying. No industry was crying.
Just a moment. You're saying, sir, I'm interrupting again. You're saying that they did not heed the warnings of the coal secretary of the day because they thought he was making warnings that weren't justified.
Let me complete. Because if you don't let me complete, the purpose will not be served. What I was saying was that the situation was such that the Coal India managers were now going to the GenCos to pick up coal because they were sitting on loads of coal at pit heads and there were no takers. If that be the situation, it's anybody's call. They thought it's so comfortable. Why is this coal secretary shouting? Now, I was thinking 5 years ahead. Not many governments think 5 years ahead. Not many. And let's admit this throughout. I mean, I don't think many governments think. They think that we are comfortable. Why are you shouting unnecessarily? And I don't blame them because probably half of my own colleagues felt, why are you shouting? I was looking 5 years ahead. I said, if you don't work on the mines at this point in time, we might run into problem. So it was something which could have been debated at that point in time. I don't think government understood that point or bureaucrats understood that point because ultimately I was talking within the bureaucracy and I was trying to convince others that why, because it was whether
okay,
the
sir,
coal
I'm
mine-
I'm stopping you again. Because I think it's important we should get a focus. I'm just repeating some of the things you said because they're critical. You said their response was, why is the coal secretary shouting? You said you were thinking 5 years ahead of the problems that would emerge. The government wasn't inclined to think that far ahead because they thought they had a comfortable situation in 2016. And you added, the government didn't understand how the situation could change. Now, if you don't want to accept the word irresponsibility, would you say that this is a clear sign of a government that failed to think ahead, something that governments are required to do, that chose instead to ignore the warnings of its own coal secretary rather than take them seriously? And therefore, this is a problem that is created by the government's mishandling.
As I was trying to explain to you, it is very clear at that point in time, you could have taken any view. I was trying to visualize what could be the possible consequences of a decision that the government was taking. And I was clearly presenting my point of view. Those on the other side of the table felt that I'm unnecessarily crying wolf. There's no serious problem. And as you mentioned earlier, from the industry also, there was no cry.
Sir, is this one thing? Now we're repeating ourselves. Is this or is this not mishandling by the government after 2016?
I see. I can in a way, in hindsight wisdom, I can say that probably government mishandled it. It's hindsight wisdom.
It's all right. Whether it's with hindsight or with foresight doesn't matter. You agree
this matters. See, I have worked. Let me explain. Let us be fair to the government at that point. I worked in the government for 38 years. That's how most of the governments function. Let's try and understand. It's not right, but that's how they function. I have yet to see a government, and I have held pretty critical assignments, who can think 5 years ahead. I was thinking 5 years ahead. They didn't agree with me. They thought Swachh Bharat was very important, which I also thought was very important. My only contention was that Coal India could give the money, but why have coal managers sitting there? They never thought that this would be the implication.
Okay, I'll accept that. I think we've come down to a consensus. This is mishandling with hindsight. The coal secretary was thinking 5 years ahead. The government was not prepared to do so. Your excuse for the government not doing so is that governments in India usually don't think 5 years ahead. That suggests that there's a problem with governments in India per se, rather than specifically with this one. But mishandling in hindsight is what you're saying this government is guilty of. Would you accept that? Because those are your words.
Absolutely. They could have. They should have.
And they should have acted differently. Yeah. You're silent.
I said they should have acted.
They should have, and also they could have acted differently. That's absolutely clear. So we've established two things in this interview so far. You've explained in fairly considerable detail the reasons why we have a problem today. And you agree that the responsibility is the government's with hindsight. This is, as you said, mishandling with hindsight. The government could have and should have acted differently. Let me now ask you, as a former coal secretary, how critical is the situation the country faces today? You're aware that several state governments are talking about possible blackouts. The Economic Times today reports that there is load shedding already happening in four states. They are Uttar Pradesh, Maharashtra, Punjab, and Rajasthan. The power minister, on the other hand, is categorically saying that panic is being created for no rhyme or reason whatsoever. Hence my question, as a former coal secretary, how critical is the situation today?
See, I am not the right person to determine how critical it is, because my understanding is based on the readings of newspapers, whatever little I have read on the internet. So it's all based on what they're saying. Whether it's critical or not is not the issue. I think we are debating the wrong issue today. We are debating whether there is a crisis or not. Irrespective of whether there's a crisis or not, there is admittedly shortage of coal. This has to be admitted. And we should try and address how do we overcome the shortage of coal instead of just debating whether there's a crisis or not. If there is a crisis, people will feel it. If there is not a crisis, people will feel it. How does it help us? It helps us if we understand the cause of whether there is a crisis or not and try and address. You know, as a civil servant, my job always was first recognize whatever that is happening, but don't unnecessarily spend time on debating on that, but to find out the causes of it and then see how it can be addressed. So the key point is, how do we address the problem?
Let's come in the end to that key point. As you said, let's not debate whether there's a crisis. Some people will call it a crisis, others won't. But what is admittedly clear and cannot be denied is that there is a shortage of coal. What then are the steps the government should take?
Let us take one by one. First, let us understand the short-term steps that can be taken. Short-term steps will relate to understanding where all coal is available in whichever pit heads. These pit heads could be Coal India Limited pit heads or private sector pit heads. Because on an average, we can say there's the shortage, but there would be some places where there's surplus coal available, some places there will not be surplus. So movement of this coal in coordination with railways is extremely, extremely important. You know, I'm assuming, and I saw it in 2015 also, some private coal mines have surplus coal sitting on them, but they can't sell it because under the arrangement, they are not commercial mines. They have to use it for capital purposes. Now, this will have to be enabled. How do you enable it? You can enable it by allowing these companies to send coal to places where there is shortage and not allowing them to sell it, but to be replenished subsequently by Coal India. So you will not be you know, violating the agreement that you had with them, because the moment you allow the commercial sale, it will be violating the agreement, and that has to be avoided. This can be done easily, number one. Number two, it has to be immediately ascertained, why didn't the power gencos, the generating companies, stock coal for 20 days? My understanding is, and this is some of the feedback that I've got, is large number of generating companies were not keeping coal for 20 days when there was surplus coal available. I've also got to know that Coal India is dispatching a lot of coal, but Genco's generation companies, since they maintain inventory, they have to pay the money. So they keep their inventory at the lowest level. This has to be found out. These are short-term measures that can be taken. But I think more important, and I'm sure they're tied over it, as you know, as now we don't have rainfall, the production will increase and it will get tided over. But the real problem is the medium and long-term preparation. So here, first of all, the human resource problem should be sorted out immediately. The Bharat Coking Coal, which is the only coking coal company in the public sector which produces coking coal, does not have a CMD. You have a single CMD for Northern Coal Fields Limited, which is in UP, and Mahanadi Coal Field Limited, which is in Odisha. Same CMD is looking after. So this can easily be done. And not only now, I think responsibility should be fixed for not appointing not only CMDs. I am told there are a number of directors, technical directors, who are not appointed there. Human resource issue should be sorted out immediately. It can be done. It should be done, number one. Number two, I think whatever little money that Coal India has now, and I'm told it's about 10,000 crores, should now be invested in expansion of new mines and opening of new mines, expansion of existing mines and opening. There should be clear-cut plan worked out, and government should desist from taking dividend from coal industry such time we have a clear-cut expansion plan worked out and executed. Because without that, it will not work. Number three.
Anything else, sir?
No, number three. Number three, the government of India should not stop monitoring Coal India. They should start helping Coal India. You know, there's so many letters that are written. I never wrote a letter as secretary to CMD Coal India. I never wrote a letter. Picked up the phone and spoke to him. Now if by writing letter production was to increase, it would have increased long ago. It doesn't work that way. Now, what is the role that the central government has to play? Number one, it has to liaise with these state governments, not fight with them, sit with them, because state governments may listen to central government, they will not listen to Coal India, to fast track acquisition of land, to fast track environment and forest clearances. Because until this happened, even if you have land, you will not have coal mining. So that has to be done. So the whole role of the central government has to become a facilitator. They should revive the coal project monitoring group to help the private sector as well as the public sector in terms of expediting these clearances. So these are the steps that the central government should take in terms of long-term measures that would ultimately lead to increase in coal production.
Can I put this to you? The short-term measures are pretty straightforward. Hopefully the government will do them when there's a sense of perceived crisis. Governments do tend to respond because it affects their popularity. The medium and long-term measures, as far as I've understood them, seem to suggest the government needs to change the attitude it's shown to the coal industry for the last 3 years. You want them to fill jobs that they've left vacant, presumably deliberately or carelessly, for a year and more. Now they have to quickly fill them and change their attitude to those jobs. You want them to change their attitude and relationship with the states and not quarrel with them, but actually liaise with them. You also want them to stop monitoring Coal India, but pick up the phone and help them. And finally, you want them to revive CPMG, but CPMG was allowed to go defunct by this government. So your medium and long-term measures are actually asking the government to change its mindset and reverse what it's done. How likely is it that will happen?
No. Karan, I am asking the government to do what this government did between 2014 and 16.
Yes, but this government didn't do it after 2016. That's the point you made.
No, they may not have done it.
Asking them to go back.
No, I am not asking for anything utopian. This is something which was done by this government, and results were there for them to see. So they know it can be done. You know, sometimes as an expert, you tell them, do this, without having the knowledge of whether it can be done or not. Here is a very practical suggestion of something which was done.
Okay. And I'll put it like this, sir. You're asking the government to go back to the attitude and to the manner and behavior that it showed in 2014 up to 2016, rather than the behavior it's shown since 2016 till today. In other words, you're asking them to go back 5 years in time. The problem is, that the last 5 years' behavior seems to be their traditional and preferred practice. You're asking them to give that up. Let's hope they see the wisdom of what you're saying and heed your advice and realize that, in fact, you're only asking them to do what they did earlier. The problem is they have to stop doing what they've done for the last 5 years. And that, many will think, is a pretty insuperable problem for a government that always believes it knows best. But let's hope they're hearing you, because I think you have put your finger on the problem very clearly. And I'll emphasize for the audience what you eventually agreed to describe the situation as: mishandling by hindsight. And as you said, the government could have and should have acted differently. I would say that's a problem this government has created. I thank you, Mr. Swaroop, for this interview, and in particular for your insight in explaining how the problem began, why it has gone the way it has, what now needs to be done. Take care, sir. Stay safe.
Thank you.